It's my pleasure to welcome you to the 14th annual Carol W. Samuelson Lecture in Public Health Practice, held in 2017, and I'll explain that in a little bit. This annual endowed lecture honors one of our community's most respected leaders, Dr. Carol Samuelson. There is no other person in our community who embodied so completely the ideals, spirit, and courage of public health than Carol. And I'm reminded each year that what an honor it is to have her name and all the good public health works it means associated with UAB and the UAB School of Public Health. The Carol W. Samuelson Lecture focuses on public health practice. Past lectures have been on the politics of lead poisoning, the decline of the public health infrastructure, impacts of public health studies on the general population, to name a few. This lecture honors Carol for her outstanding service through years of devoted commitment to the Jefferson County Department of Health, as well as many other community and statewide organizations interested in ensuring good health for all. In all her professional and community activities, Carol led with diligence and innovation while always placing the public first. The Samuelson Lecture was created to honor her passion for excellence, as well as to continue her tradition of intellectual innovation and community involvement. Carol was indeed that rare community leader whose heart and soul was bound in their works, life's work, to guarantee that for others, life was filled with possibilities and opportunities. Her untimely death saddens us all who knew Carol and so often followed her lead towards efforts to improve the health and well-being of everyone in our community, most especially the disenfranchised and marginalized. The legacy of her work in many ways in public health and this endowed lecture give life and voice to her vision and hopes for better places for people to live, work, and play. To recognize her courage, tenacity, and leadership in promoting quality health and educational services to the public, in 2002, her friends and colleagues established the Carol W. Samuelson Endowed Lectureship in Public Health Practice at the UAB School of Public Health. Very special thanks go to Paul Samuelson, Carol's husband. Thank you, Paul, for his enduring support of this lecture. We appreciate you being here today. I'd also like to recognize President Ray Watts, president of UAB. Appreciate you being here. And also like to thank and recognize members of the Broad Street Committee, the advisory committee for the School of Public Health. So as I mentioned, this lecture is traditionally delivered in the fall of every year. We were unable to coordinate our schedules this year with Jennifer, so she's here. So this is the 2016 Samuelson Lecture in early 2017. All that said, it is now truly my pleasure to introduce this year's speaker, Jennifer Bradley. Ms. Bradley is the director of the newly established Center for Urban Innovation at the Aspen Institute and co-author of The Metropolitan Revolution. Ms. Bradley's presence today builds on the momentum catalyzed by Bruce Katz's visit, giving the same lecture in the fall of 2014. From that visit came a movement in Birmingham to capitalize on our various assets to build an innovation economy through a new effort called Innovate Birmingham. President Ray Watts has led Innovate Birmingham through his role as president of the Birmingham Business Alliance and will continue in that role through the next year. As this year's presenter of the Samuelson Lecture, Jennifer Bradley brings a timely and critical perspective to Innovate Birmingham, namely that of inclusion. Inclusion is an increasingly important feature of innovation districts and zones across the nation, in large part because they all have an urban hub that encompasses or abuts poor, predominantly African-American neighborhoods. Her work with communities across the nation has highlighted the importance of working with local communities to understand their needs for and concepts of an innovation economy. Inclusion is the essential ingredient of Birmingham's past, as Birmingham is the crucible of the most important social movement of the 20th century, civil rights. Exactly 1 week ago today, President Obama designated the Civil Rights District as a national monument. This designation recognizes the pivotal role Birmingham played in the civil rights movement and creates limitless opportunities for the city to serve as a national and world leader in civil rights and inclusion. Jennifer Bradley's work at the Center for Urban Innovation focuses on the importance and challenges of including the residents of our local communities and neighborhoods in a new innovation economy. We may be early in the process developing a strategy to make Birmingham's innovation economy a world leader, which gives us the unique opportunity to build on our civil rights legacy to assure that inclusion is part of our mantra, a moral imperative, if you will, of our innovation economy. Jennifer has worked extensively on the challenges and opportunities of older industrial cities and has co-authored major economic turnaround strategies for Ohio and Michigan. She has also written for Newsweek, The New Republic, The Atlantic Monthly, and New American City. She's a former attorney who co-authored several Supreme Court briefs and cases that affirm the constitutional powers of local governments and secure greater environmental protections, including the landmark case Massachusetts versus the EPA. And all the other information's about Jennifer's on the flyer. So please join me in welcoming Jennifer Bradley to UAB in Birmingham to deliver the annual Carol Samuelson Lecture in Public Health Practice.
I'm grateful to Dean Max Michael, to the School of Public Health, to Paul Samuelson, and the creators and supporters of the Carol W. Samuelson Lecture. It's absolutely an honor to be here, and I've already learned so much from my short time in Birmingham. The invitation to give a lecture connected to public health has been a great opportunity for me to think about my own discipline and area of work. I've realized that urban thinkers and researchers are also in the business of supporting public health. We don't use the terminology of public health. Like every specialty, we have our own code words and private language. But if you think about what the words public and health mean broadly, you can see incredible areas of alignment. To an urbanist, public means not just a particular set of people, but a physical realm. We think about things like public space, public transportation, public goods, and the public sector policies, like funding streams, that support them. The public is, ideally, what we have in common. It's our spaces for shared celebration, for commemoration, and the experience of daily life. It's all of these places, these shared public spaces, that give cities and communities their emotional resonance. When y'all consider things like health, you look at things like birth rates, or rates of diabetes, or incidence of cancer. Urbanists measure things like foot traffic, ridership rates, funding streams, access to jobs, and patent rates. Both fields, though, understand the strong link between people and place, and how the health and vitality of the public realm supports the mental and physical health of individuals. So urbanists and public health practitioners both care about the social determinants of health. Things like access to parks and safe sidewalks, education, discrimination, inclusion, and the role of place in health expressed through indicators like access to fresh and nutritious foods. The overlapping notions between public health and urbanism are the starting point for this speech. And as I prepared for this speech, I realized that public health was a powerful starting point for an explanation about how cities can work to enhance human capabilities, that there are a set of policies and practices that have thwarted the optimal function of cities and the ability of humans within them, that it's not enough to stop doing the bad stuff with policy. We have to actively move towards good policies, and I'll give a sketch of what some of those emerging good policies are. And that the turn towards good policies and good practices not only supports the better functioning of cities, it better supports innovation. And in fact, the better functioning of cities in some ways is the same as support for innovation. First, though, I want to talk about some interesting research in the public health realm that particularly resonated with me as an urbanist and urban practitioner. And that's specifically a notion of the capability to be healthy. So what does that mean? According to Sridhar Venkatapuram, who developed this notion, he's a public health expert based in London, health goes far beyond the absence of disease. Drawing on the work of economists and philosophers, he has developed the idea of the right to the capability to be healthy, which means the ability to achieve 10 things. First, live a normal length of lifespan, have good health, maintain bodily integrity, which so far I think are pretty standard factors in public health. but that's only a partial list. The other items on this list move into a broader realm of policy, philosophy, and really what it means to be human. Those are use these senses, the imagination, and think, have emotions and emotional attachments, form an idea of the good life, have meaningful and respectful social affiliations, express concern for other species, be able to play, which is an essential human capacity, and have control over the material and political environment. This is an ambitious list. It moves far beyond the realm of medicine and into the realm of social and the adjacent realm, as I was saying earlier, of the public. What are the things that we do when we come together in public? And what do public spaces make possible? These capabilities grow not only in the body, the mind, and in the home, but also on the street, in the park, in nature, and in society. As Venkatapuram explains, the capability to be healthy erases the sharp distinction between the individual and social environment. It reflects the recognition of how the environment can profoundly shape a person's self-perceptions of their own functions. And so as an urbanist, I always come back to the question of where. Where does something happen? And does that particular where, does that particular place support or hinder what it is that people want to achieve with a particular policy or practice? So when I look at this list of capabilities, I think, what are the kinds of places that support the capability to be healthy? Not just in body, although we learn more every single day about the relationship between the physical environment and physical and mental health, but in other expressions of health. At their best, I think cities are wonderful places. They're not the only places, but I think they're wonderful places to develop these 10 capabilities. This idea of cities as actually promoting health flips on its head the old idea left over from the late 19th and early 20th centuries that cities are inherently unhealthy places. We think of cities as places of dirt and pollution, of contagion and of stress. But in fact, if you look at rates of heart disease, cancer, unintentional injuries, chronic lower respiratory disease, and stroke, which are the 5 leading causes of death in the United States, you can see that metropolitan areas are in fact healthier than non-metropolitan areas. Again, moving beyond just actual bodily health, cities are also places that can stimulate and sometimes overstimulate the senses. They have historically been the home of artists, writers, and inventors. So remember that one of the capabilities that I mentioned earlier is the ability to exercise the imagination and the emotions. Cities also expose people to a huge range of ideas of what the good life consists in. And I think that's why people have, at times, been disparaging or fearful of cities. Somebody might catch not just a disease, but a new idea that causes them to break with tradition, behave in a new way, and just generally really upset their mom and dad. Cities are also important to material well-being. Research has shown that workers gain what's known as a skills premium when they move to metropolitan areas, and that skills premium stays with them when they leave. Cities enable residents to get smarter and more skilled faster. There are more opportunities to learn and grow, and more competition, which again pushes faster improvement. Cities are also where inventions tend to cluster. This inventive power of cities has been the case for centuries. Historian Thomas Bender has found that between 1866 and 1886, the era in which Edison was perfecting his light bulb, 80% of the most prolific inventors of telegraph-related technology lived in or within commuting distance of New York City. Now, you might think that that makes perfect sense because in the 19th century, it was very hard for ideas and for people, even, to travel across great distances. So, of course, proximity mattered. But 150 years later, proximity still matters right? There's a reason we have universities in defined physical spaces. Research has shown that 82% of the inventors who were granted patents in the United States between 2005 and 2012 lived in one of the largest 100 metropolitan areas, and that patents within metropolitan areas tend to be cited disproportionately by other patent applications from the same metropolitan area, meaning that with all of our advances in technology and teleconferencing and the internet and searches, we are still learning the most from the people who are within the ambit of our daily lives. If you think about Silicon Valley and the tremendous concentration of talent, companies, and venture capital there, you see almost a deep irony in the fact that technology, which was supposed to cut the ties between people and places and allow people anywhere to work from anywhere, turns out to flourish in fairly compact geographic concentrations. So why do cities have this power? Cities have and maximize this power of invention because they're places of mixing, places where ideas, approaches, skills, and problems, both old and new, meet and recombine. So let's talk about that example again of Edison in the 19th century in New York. Edison perfected the first commercially viable incandescent light bulb in 1879 in his laboratory in Menlo Park, New Jersey. But he depended on a web of like-minded inventors, craftspeople, engineers, financiers, and yes, even lawyers. He needed not only a laboratory, but also a marketing hub and a large-scale demonstration site, which he found in two locations in Manhattan. The mix of readily available expertise, ingenuity, space, and inspiration could only be found in a metropolis. Arguably, it took a city and its surroundings to bring the light bulb into being. As I'll explain later, mixing, which is the combination of old and new, science and craft, idea and deployment, is also a reasonable definition of what innovation itself is, and why cities and innovation can be such a perfect fit, and what that might mean for your future here in Birmingham. But before we get to the future, we have to look at the past. Cities can be amazing places for mixing, but across centuries, continents, and cultures, people who planned, built, and led cities practiced an urbanism of exclusion, division, and separation. Laws, policies, and practices prevented mixing. Zoning laws in the United States prevented the mixing of different kinds of urban uses in the middle parts of the 20th century, separating not only factories, tanneries, and other smelly, dirty, and toxic uses from homes, but also separating businesses, stores, and other neighborhood conveniences from where people lived. In fact, some of the streets and neighborhoods that we find so delightful today or that are tremendously in demand and command sky-high prices are in fact illegal under current zoning codes. You couldn't recreate about 40% of Manhattan, some of the most highly valued real estate in the world, under today's zoning code. And this example is replicated in places like Portland, in certain communities around Boston. A lot of the built environment that we really like is illegal because there's too much mixing going on there. Current law wants us to keep things more separate. Zoning was in part a response to genuine public health concerns of polluting factories and nuisances that were just too close to homes, schools, parks, and houses of worship. But there were other concerns at work here as well. Within residential areas, zoning laws separated multifamily apartment buildings from single-family homes in order to keep single-family property values high and to keep wealthier owners away from renters, who were not only less wealthy, but also more likely to be immigrants or people of color. So the separation of types of housing was a means to separate people, not just by class, but by race. We've all heard of redlining, the federal government sanctioned practice of saying that some neighborhoods were worth lending to and investing in, and some weren't. These neighborhoods were delineated on maps prepared by a federal government agency, the Homeowners Loan Corporation, or HOLC, and the no investment areas were covered in red, colored in red. So this is a photo of the actual redlining map of Birmingham. And what I find striking about this map, what really hit me when I first saw it, is that the different colored areas were colored in by hand. And I don't know if that comes out well. I think it does on this level of resolution. But those were colored in by hand. And I don't know how I thought red lines appeared on these maps that were made in the mid-20th century. It's not like we had an Excel spreadsheet that could sort of populate these squares without somebody picking up a red pencil. I think that I was surprised because I sometimes forget, and I think we all sometimes forget, that policy is a human creation, much like a sandwich or a painting or an automobile. We say things like, the law is, or the policy requires us to, and we forget the people who wrote the laws and the policies and the rules and all the people behind them. So to make this map, some human being picked up a red pencil and colored in some squares, the same way a child might do with a coloring book, and lives changed and neighborhoods changed. There was nothing inevitable about this. This is the work of human hands. This division was not just, as you know, a Southern tragedy. It's a little harder to see the colorations on this map of Providence, Rhode Island, but if you look sort of in the top center, there's an outline of red in those maps. There are about 250 red line maps available online, digitized. A group called the Mapping Inequality Project has created a site where people can compare the old red line maps with current landmarks and streets to better understand how the past influences the present geography of wealth and opportunity in cities. Because while redlining is officially illegal, we're still feeling the consequences of these separations today. There is a persistent racial wealth gap between blacks and whites in the United States. The median white family has 13 times the wealth of the median black family. And at current rates of wealth accumulation, it will take 228 years to close this gap. The gap is not just a result of the difference in white and black earnings, but in assets like homes that build wealth. And that wealth is then passed down through generations. And I'm not talking about people who inherit millions of dollars and trust funds. I'm talking about a few thousand dollars that families can use to add to a down payment, maybe from their parents or from their grandparents. Researchers at Brandeis University looked at about 25 years worth of data from the mid-1980s through 2000, and they found several reasons why whites have enjoyed a greater surge of home equity and therefore wealth than African Americans. First, residential segregation artificially lowers demand. So there's a ceiling, effectively, on how high home values and therefore home equity can go in non-white neighborhoods where African Americans tend to live. Second, home equity is closely tied to how long you've owned your home. So the longer you've held the asset, the more time it's had to appreciate in value. Because whites are able to use this intergenerational transfer of wealth, these inheritances or family assistance for down payments, white families can buy homes and start building equity on their homes an average of 8 years earlier than black families. So that's a snowballing effect on wealth accumulation. Because whites are far more able to give family financial assistance, larger upfront payments by white homeowners lower interest rates and lending costs, which, again, leads to faster equity accumulation. And finally, due to historic differences in access to credit, lower incomes, and factors such as residential segregation, the homeownership rate for white families is almost 30% higher than the homeownership rate for black families. So again, you start with red lines on a map, and you end up with an intergenerational snowballing effect. So the roots of inequality, you can erase the red lines, but it's much harder to undo the cumulative generational effects of inequality and segregation. I could walk through a similar analysis that shows things like where transit investments go and don't go, where highways were run through neighborhoods where land was cheap because of redlining, where bus lines stop at city borders, where there are too few parks and green spaces and sidewalks and bike lanes and grocery stores. People made decisions about how cities were built, designed, and paid for, and those decisions were for separation and against mixing. Human beings, hands with red pencils, created spaces and neighborhoods in a public realm that excluded and minimized a significant, creative, and valuable part of the public. That effort was focused and intentional, and it was very successful. These decisions created some opportunities for capacity development for some people and sharply limited the ability of other people to develop their capacities. Cities in the United States, when they did these things, were choking off possibilities not only for individuals, but also for their own economies and their culture. So the history that I've just described is a far cry from the idealized vision of a city where people come to learn, imagine, interact, and create together, where people have meaningful and respectful social interactions and affiliations and control over their material and political environment. So how can I possibly stand here and talk about the promise of the city and why cities are these wonderful places to come together and share and mix and create? How can I talk about cities being places of inclusion when their history and the right this minute present belies this ideal in so many ways? I'm optimistic about the power of cities. I'm not foolishly optimistic, but I'm persistently optimistic because of current efforts to be intentional in the direction of mixing, not just to stop doing the bad things, but to actively move towards good things. That's a moral and social obligation to put as much effort into inclusion and mixing as previous generations put into exclusion and separation. This journey is closer to the beginning than it is to the end. But there are signs that really smart and creative economists and people in other disciplines are influencing urbanists, the people who think about cities, the people who think about where stuff goes and therefore who has access to what, to do more of the right stuff and support inclusion and mixing and these feedstocks for innovation. In cities across the country, there is an effort to create more inclusive economies and more inclusive economic development. So Pittsburgh has an inclusive innovation roadmap, and this is a screen grab from the material they have online. Washington, D.C. and Austin are working on inclusive growth plans. In the greater Cleveland area, as well as in several neighborhoods in New York City, philanthropies and community groups are coming together to connect economic development and community development so that new jobs and new sources of revenue counteract rather than reinforce patterns of inequality. Detroit, Baltimore, Seattle, Portland, Minneapolis, St. Paul, there is a growing list of cities that are trying to grow differently and more equitably. City builders are realizing that we cannot afford continuing exclusion. Economists used to believe that there was a trade-off between equity and growth, that policies that supported equity hindered efficiency and slowed down the growth machinery. But new research shows that, in some circumstances, equity and growth are complements. The Nobel Prize-winning economist Joseph Stiglitz has written, "The bottom line that higher inequality is associated with lower growth, controlling for all other relevant factors, has been verified by looking at a range of countries and looking over longer periods of time." This is also true at the metropolitan scale. Disparities between jurisdictions in a region and segregation by race and class, along with sprawl, act as a drag on a region's economic growth potential. The Rockefeller Foundation has supported research into the five characteristics of an inclusive economy. This list is also informed by the capabilities theory, which is the list of 10 things that I put up at the beginning of this speech, and you can see echoes of one in the other. And I imagine you can also map a lot of the social determinants of health factors onto this list as well. So I'll walk through them quickly. Equity means people have access to a more solid economic foundation, including equal access to adequate public goods, services, and infrastructure, such as public transit, education, clean air, and water. Participation is the second factor, and it means that people are able to participate fully in economic life and have greater say over their future. Transparency around and common knowledge of rules and norms allow people to start a business, find a job, or engage in markets. The third element is growth. An economy is increasingly producing enough goods and services to enable broad gains in well-being and greater opportunity. Fourth is stability. Individuals, households, communities, and enterprises are secure enough to invest in their future. Economic systems are increasingly resilient to shocks and stresses, whether those are economic or environmental, especially to disruptions with a disproportionate impact on poor or vulnerable communities. And I think that this point about stability is really important. A lot of people in the innovation business get somewhat intoxicated, I think, by the idea of disruption. And we don't always think with respect and honor towards people who have been on the losing end of disruption, people for whom disruption has been a bad thing. So I think that this emphasis on trying to balance the disruptions that are inherent in innovation with the stability that people need to build and predict and move along with their lives is a really important point. And finally, there's sustainability. Economic and social wealth is sustained over time, and decision-making incorporates long-term costs and benefits. And this is not just a compilation of theories. People are working now on how to measure each of these elements of inclusive economies and how to tie it back to practices and human actions. These ideas are guiding investments and decision-making, not just in city governments, but across the networks of other institutions like universities, philanthropies, and other institutions that create and build cities. The urgency to act on this understanding that equity and growth can go together is made all the more powerful by demographic change. My son, who is white, is 14 years old right now. In 5 years, when he's 19, he will, as a white person, be a minority among the cohort of people who are under the age of 20 in the United States. As my former colleague William Fry points out in his book, Diversity Explosion, as the baby boom generation ages out of the workforce, the primary working age population in the United States will experience a net loss of 15 million whites between 2010 and 2030. Meanwhile, the share of people of color that are labor force age will steadily grow, especially the youngest segments of the working age population. And as immigrants spread out beyond traditional gateways and native-born people of color also move to new areas in search of new jobs or a new way of life, more and more communities will face a future that is markedly more ethnically and racially diverse than their past. The good news is that the growth of working-age populations of color will enable the United States labor force to grow, albeit slowly, in the coming decade. That growth in the labor force is absolutely essential to a strong economic growth rate. But imagine how much we limit ourselves and our capacity to grow if the majority of the population in the coming decades, people of color, have not been supported in developing their capabilities and skills, if they've continually been excluded. At the metropolitan level, a more skilled workforce accelerates economic growth. And so that's why inclusion, spreading the benefits of growth and innovation to communities that have traditionally been on the margins, matters so much. This is our future. So now finally, we're landing on the link between innovation and inclusion. The casual idea we have about innovation, the one celebrated in the media and in so many of our stories, is wrong. We think an innovator looks like this, or like this, or like this. In fact, innovators look like this. Innovation is a team sport, and it has been through many eras and many kinds of places. One reason that collaboration is essential will be familiar to anyone who has faced the equivalent of writer's block in their own discipline. Individual minds just get stuck. The writer Stephen Johnson describes research on the process of innovation in four top molecular biology labs. And his description, I think, will be familiar to anyone here in a university environment. He explains the group helped recontextualize problems as questions from colleagues forced researchers to think about their experiments on a different scale or level. Group interactions challenged researchers' assumptions about their more surprising findings, making them less likely to dismiss something unusual as individual error. Productive analogies between different specialized fields were more likely to emerge in the conversation setting of the lab meeting. Johnson concludes that even with all the advanced technology of a leading molecular biology lab, the most productive tool for generating good ideas remains a circle of humans at a table, talking shop. Another reason that collaboration matters is that innovations, as I've said before, are new combinations of existing ideas, just like people are new combinations of existing sets of DNA. And just like a lack of genetic diversity can cause problems within a population, a lack of idea diversity can cause problems, or at least confine what's possible in terms of invention, creation, and problem solving. If you surround yourself with people who are trained like you, who have the same experience as you, the same problem-solving toolkits as you, how likely are you to find a new combination or new approach? Now, at this point, I'm going to move into some rather tricky territory, from the diversity of ideas to the more common notion of diversity found in today's companies and campuses. There is evidence that more diverse teams, diverse in terms of racial and gender composition, get better results. That's not because idea diversity is the same as identity diversity. African American women do not all think in one way that is somehow different from the way Latina women or Asian women or white women think. But there is some connection between our experiences and the ideas that we put on the table and the problems that we recognize as problems. As Scott Page of the University of Michigan writes, the sources of innovation remain mysterious. Life experiences can serendipitously provide insights. By building diverse teams of employees, organizations increase their chances of making a breakthrough. In a world in which stereotypes affect not just how we see each other, but even how we see ourselves, different experiences of the world mean that we bring different connections, mental associations, frameworks, and heuristics to the table. The more approaches you have, the richer the mix, the greater the chance that the right ingredients for the next big move or breakthrough are available. Page and his research puts this into a nice formula, which is 1 + 1 = 3. Basically, if people see different approaches or solutions to a problem, they create more ways to solve that problem. So you have the approach of person A, you have the approach of person B, and then you have the combined approach of A plus B. And what's important here is interaction. Person A and person B have to be interacting with each other for their ideas to build on one another. Page gives the delightful example of the ice cream cone, which he says was invented at the 1904 World's Fair in St. Louis when an ice cream vendor ran out of cups on a hot day. The vendor next door sold waffles, and he rolled some up to make cones. So in this case, we have 1 + 1 = ice cream cone. There's another interesting finding in research, which is we behave differently when we're solving problems in collaboration with people who are socially unlike us. Catherine Phillips of Columbia Business School has looked at several studies of how diversity actually causes more innovative results. She finds that being with similar others leads us to think that we all hold the same information and share the same perspective. She cites a study in which each member of an all-white group of people were assigned to solve a mystery puzzle, and each one had a specific element of information. It's a bit like the game Clue, right? Everybody had a card that if the cards were all combined, they would solve the mystery. But because they thought, well, everybody knows what I know, they didn't share all of their information fully, and so they couldn't solve a perfectly solvable problem. Further studies have shown that when a black person presented a dissenting perspective to a group of whites, the perspective was perceived as more novel and led to broader thinking and consideration of alternatives than when a white person introduced exactly that same dissenting perspective. Diversity, the mere sort of physical presence of diversity, jolts us into cognitive action in ways that homogeneity simply does not. This is not to say that diversity is easier or harmonious. It's not all ice cream cones. It can lead to more discomfort and even conflict, but it's worth the difficulty. It leads to better outcomes. In the work I'm creating at the Center for Urban Innovation at the Aspen Institute, I'm concerned with inclusive innovation, which I define as innovations that benefit underserved and marginalized communities, or are created by people from underserved and marginalized communities. If I were to add to the list of 10 human capabilities that I started with, I would add the capability to create. I think that this is a profoundly human capability, closely related to imagination, thinking, social affiliations, control over the environment, and play. What drew me to this idea? 2 years ago, almost to the day, I came to work at the Aspen Institute and realized that I was in some ways in a position analogous to that of many startup founders. I wasn't looking to build a zillion-dollar tech company, much to the dismay of my husband, but instead I was charged with creating a product or service that had not previously existed and finding an audience who would pay for it, which in my case means philanthropic foundations. I'd never done anything like that before, so in addition to reading more and more about innovation and collaboration, I started to read about startups, and in particular the book, The Lean Startup. Eric Ries, the author of The Lean Startup, expressed something in his book that at first glance seemed astonishing to me. He wrote that successful startups do not present customers with a finished product and sit back while sales go through the roof. Successful startups enlist customers as co-creators of their products. A feature that engineers might think was ridiculous and simple and not very important could turn out to be what a particular group of customers loved most. And they might not care about a feature that was brilliant technically, but actually didn't address their real needs. And I realized that this notion of enlisting customers or constituents or the people that you're trying to help as co-creators was something that I'd heard of before, but hadn't fully appreciated. When I was writing The Metropolitan Revolution with Bruce Katz, I saw this approach both in how New York City, under Mayor Bloomberg, tried to reorient its economy after the financial sector collapse in 2008, and how a major social service organization in Houston changed its approach to serving its clients. In Houston, they like to say that the change begins with the first new question. And that question is often, what do you think? If startups can rely on customers for information, if the New York City Economic Development Corporation can ask businesses what they need, if a Houston social services agency can ask refugees in economically poor communities, what's good about this place and how do you contribute to it? I thought, why can't we ask underserved communities to be co-creators of the solutions for their lives? The answer is, we can do that. And cutting-edge practitioners in a number of fields are doing exactly that. They understand the importance of listening to and learning from the people that they're trying to serve. Scholars, researchers, and philanthropists have collected examples of feedback and co-creation improving outcomes in settings as varied as Ugandan health facilities, the Cleveland Clinic, and public schools in 20 cities in the United States. This means doctors appreciating the wisdom of their patients, teachers being guided by their students, and international development projects drawing on the wisdom of villagers and not just economists. This practice is starting to take root in the United States as well. Albuquerque, Atlanta, Baltimore, New Orleans, and Seattle have just completed an 18-month boot camp on how their city governments can better listen to constituents, going beyond the typical notion of citizen engagement, which too often is like a one-way radio broadcast, to something that's more extensive. And I have to be honest, one thing that these five cities have learned is that it's frustrating and time-consuming to do this, but it's ultimately more successful, and more rewarding. The investments that you put in up front will pay off further down the road. And I think this is absolutely the next frontier in innovation. Harder problems need more mind, and exclusion, separation, and inequality is the hardest problem that we are facing as a society, and given what we know about economic growth and what we know about demographic trends, there is not a more urgent problem. There must be more inclusion in innovation, and we must be more innovative when it comes to including people. So the challenge I'm putting to you today is, can Birmingham be the place that takes the lead in these kinds of innovations, in innovation around inclusion? Do you have the civic resources and the civic courage to try and fail and learn, to try better and fail again and learn some more, and try even better and fail yet again until finally you keep learning and one of your tries pays off? Can you take on the hardest challenges? Can you draw on old and new, past and present, university and neighborhood, science and the humanities, technology and empathy to create the tools, processes, methods, and measurements that would make the 10 capabilities or the 5 characteristics of inclusive economic development real? Can you find breakthroughs? You don't have to do all 15, right? Even one or two would be magnificent. When I was talking to Bruce Katz about this lecture, you know, sharing ideas, asking him what he learned when he was here, we together wondered if Birmingham's big innovation could in fact be the next generation of civil rights. Can your civil rights history encompass not only your museums and your heritage sites, but also your laboratories, your startups, your creative institutions and businesses, your innovation network? Can it be the source material for a new set of processes, practices, and tools? Other places across the country are working in a similar direction. Again, Detroit, Philadelphia, Pittsburgh, Cleveland, Austin, Washington, D.C. are thinking about forging a shared and durable prosperity. And they have some advantages, but none of them have your civic history. None of them have Birmingham's social DNA. With steel and civil rights, Birmingham made an indelible mark on the 20th century. What will you make in the 21st? I invite and challenge Birmingham to set this course for itself, invent the better future, and invite the world to come and learn. Thank you very much.